presence of God, whose word has called the earth and the stars into being. In the presence of God, whose arms have held children.
We stand in trust.
In the presence of God, whose breath has stirred within us and caused our hearts to thirst for justice.
We stand in need.
Before you, giver of life, we come in faith, in search of love and wholeness.
We stand ready.
In the presence of God, whose house and home this is,
we come in peace and we come for peace.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is our time to greet one another in the peace of Christ, and as this is cold and flu season, I encourage you to greet one another possibly with the fist bump of love or the elbow touch of compassion, however it is you'd like to salute one another and say, welcome, I embrace you, you are my brother, you are my sister, please do so at this time. Good morning and welcome to Old South Church in Boston. We are so glad to have each and every one of you here with us this morning. You are all so beautiful. You are all so blessed. And we could not have worship without each and every one of you. It is your presence that helps us to be church together. And so if you would take a moment and pass around the black friendship pads that are in your pews, that helps us to know who is here today, who is making up this body of Christ in this place at this moment. There's a lot going on today, and it is a very special Sunday in the life of the church. It is Consecration Sunday, when each of us takes a moment to think about the great gifts we've been given and how we might like to use them for building up the church, and this church in particular. If you're a visitor for the first time, we welcome you with a wide embrace. We are so glad to see you and hope that you will come and be a regular. And if it's your 1,000th time through the door, we welcome you with just the same kind of welcome, for we are so glad to be the body of Christ together. Welcome. Let us worship together.
The reading comes from Mark's Gospel, the 12th chapter, verses 41 through 44. Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury, many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then Jesus called his disciples and said to them,
"Truly, I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on."
A reading from the Word of God.
Hello, my name is John Wadlington. I have been a member of Old South Church for over 12 years now. This church has been with me through a lot, from the happy occasion of the birth of my daughter Anna 12 years ago, to the recent death of my mother this past Thanksgiving. As a wonderful result, we became family. As with all families, we're made up of individuals, some quiet, some kooky, some richer, some poorer, some who come to church every Sunday, and some who attend less frequently. Together, we make up the body of Old South Church. All of us get something from our involvement in the church, and we all have something to give. At this time of the church year, we are talking about our stewardship of the church. A steward is someone who takes care of something, manages something, looks after something. So when we think about our stewardship of Old South Church, we need to consider this. How do we take care of the church that takes such good care of us? To put a finer point on the subject, or perhaps I should say a blunter point, we need to talk about money. Now you might be wondering how I came to be standing in front of you this morning talking about anything, much less money. I can assure you I'm wondering the same thing, because public speaking is not my bag. In any event, around mid-December, I received a gentle, hopeful email from Nancy asking if I would be willing to speak to you about why I give and why it is important to me. When I read the email, I will admit that my heart sank a bit for two reasons. The first was the one I have mentioned earlier, that public speaking is something I avoid. I'm an anesthesiologist. I spend much of my day quietly behind an ether screen, taking care of my sleeping patients, telling the few students that come my way that a good anesthesiologist is rarely noticed. Well, unless I'm putting you to sleep right now, this is certainly the opposite of being an anesthesiologist. Now, the second reason my heart sank a little at the invitation is that I knew I would say yes. And the reason I knew I needed to say yes, because I knew it was time. It was time for John, the man who has been a member of the church for 12 years, but who has studiously remained on the periphery in the balcony, which is for me basically the sanctuary's equivalent of an ether screen. It was time for me to step out of my comfort zone and give back. I will also add that it is hard to say no to a gentle, hopeful email from Nancy Taylor. I've spent a lot of time considering why I give over the last few weeks, and I've come to realize that one of the main reasons I give is that I was taught to. Much of the credit of why I give to the church goes to my parents, who set a wonderful example of generosity for me at our church in Nashville, Tennessee. When I was growing up, we were one of those go to church every Sunday, no matter what kind of families. If a snowstorm, and that was 2 inches in Nashville, made driving difficult, we would walk to church. When my three siblings and I were very young, my parents would give each of us a dime to put into the offering plate as it came around. And when we were a little older, we made a pledge ourselves. Throughout my youth, I watched as my parents continued their generosity, donating not only their money, but their time to the local YMCA, the local science museum, and the like. And though we lived well, we lived relatively modestly. Though my father was a physician, he drove a beat-up old car and sometimes simply biked to work. We would have foreign exchange students stay with us, and orphans to our house for the holidays. One year, before an orphan boy our age was to come over for Thanksgiving, my mother pulled my brothers and me aside and said, "When he leaves tonight, I want you to give him whichever of your toys he wants most." The funny thing is, I don't remember what toy he took, but I do remember the lesson in giving. My parents' teachings about generosity were consistent. My father would end almost every prayer at the breakfast or dinner table with, "And help us remember it is better to give than to receive." And my mother would read a particular poem to us every Thanksgiving. She loved children's poetry, So though it was styled for a younger audience, she read it every Thanksgiving, even through our adulthood, until a couple of years ago when I took over the helm and read it for her. I shared it at her funeral, and I will share it with you now. It's called A Good Thanksgiving, and I will try to read it with the enthusiastic inflections of my mother. Said old gentleman Gray, on a Thanksgiving day, if you want a good time, then give something away. So he sent a fat turkey to Shoemaker Price, and the shoemaker said, what a big bird, how nice. And since a good dinner's before me, I ought to give poor Widow Lee the small chicken I bought. This fine chicken, oh see, said the pleased Widow Lee, and the kindness that sent it, how precious to me. I would like to make someone as happy as I. I'll give Washerwoman Biddy my big pumpkin pie. And oh sure, Biddy said, 'tis the queen of all pies. Just to look at its yellow face gladdens my eyes. Now it's my turn, I think, and a sweet ginger cake for the motherless Finnegan children I'll bake. A sweet cake all our own, 'tis too good to be true, said the Finnegan children, Rose, Denny, and Hugh. It smells sweet of spice, and we'll carry a slice to poor little lame Jake, who has nothing that's nice. Oh, I thank you and thank you, said little lame Jake. Oh, what a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful cake. And such a big slice. I will save all the crumbs, and I'll give them to each little sparrow that comes. And the sparrows, they twittered as if they would say, like old gentleman Gray, on a Thanksgiving day, if you want a good time, then give something away. Because each character in the poem gave cheerfully according to his or her abilities, this poem reminds me of a verse in 2 Corinthians. He who sows sparingly shall reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully shall reap bountifully. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. What else does the Bible teach us about giving? In the story of the widow's mites, which we have just heard, after several wealthy people had come and made their large offerings to the church, a poor widow comes and puts the equivalent of a few pennies into the church plate. Having seen this, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, this poor widow put in more than all the other contributors to the treasury, for they have all contributed from their surplus wealth, but she from her poverty has contributed all she had, her whole livelihood. Messages about the importance of generosity are all around us. If you won't take it from the Bible verse and the Bible story I have shared, will you take it from the movie Hello, Dolly? Hello, Dolly, you might ask. Well, I was asked to make this personal. And if you, especially the men out there, are anything like me, then Hello, Dolly was one of your favorite movies growing up. But in case I'm wrong, I will take just a moment to get you up to speed. In that movie, the main male protagonist is Mr. Horace Vandegelder. He is a grumpy, miserly, Scrooge-like character who, after the clever attentions of Dolly Levi and a few extravagant musical numbers, comes to realize, and I quote, that money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth anything unless it's spread around, encouraging young things to grow. You may have noticed I have borrowed words from many others this morning, perhaps to make up for a weakness in my own, but thankfully, my words don't have to be the most amazing words to be spoken from this pulpit. They just have to be my best. my step out from behind the ether screen best. And my financial gifts to the church don't have to be the biggest the church has ever received. Like the widow's mites, they just have to be my dig deep to be a cheerful steward of the church best. If you give your money to Old South Church, we promise to treat it like manure. That is, we promise to spread it around and encourage things to grow. There's something wonderful about spreading money around, because when I can give, when you can give, it also means that each of us must at some point have realized that we already have enough. Now it's time to hear from another Dalai, the Dalai Lama. He says, when you are discontent, you always want more, more, more. Your desire can never be satisfied. But when you practice contentment, you can say to yourself, oh yes, I already have everything that I need. Cheerful giving, when nothing is expected in return, is one of the surest signs of contentment. It is the only pure form of giving, because if we expect something back, it isn't really giving, it's trading, it's bartering, it's some form of mortgage. But if we can radiate generosity, then the giving itself becomes the reward. The last borrowed words of my story this morning relate to this. The attribution is unclear, but here are the words. Even after all these years, the sun never says to the earth, "You owe me." Look what happens with a love like that. It lights the entire sky.
May I feel the warmth. just a part, even just a tenth of my own in return. Refuge nest, a home. Would it be a
God be with you.
And also with you.
May the peace of Christ dwell in your hearts. Let us pray. O most gracious and loving God, on this day our hearts, full of so many things, full of joys and full of heartache, we who have come from so many places, turn our hearts toward thanksgiving. Not because thanksgiving is the only way that we might turn to you, but because it is so sweet to do so. We are grateful, O God, for the simple things of life that you have made joyous. We are grateful for food, food to eat from your good earth. We are grateful for the homemade dinner, for the hand-me-down recipe book, the rituals of the table, things that draw us back and back generations. We are grateful for the dignity of work, that it is not merely toil, but that in working, we can feel ourselves ennobled for our days to be of use. We are grateful too for the blessing of Sabbath, that work does not define us, that it does not limit us, that our value is not capped and defined by what we do. We are grateful for the wisdom of the Sabbath, that even if we would work every day, from morning till night, there would still yet be more to do. The world would still yet be too much for us without you. Thank you for the Sabbath. And O God, although we are grateful for these gifts, and we give thanksgiving to you for them, we are mindful that not all people enjoy these same blessings. But surely, O God, surely none is devoid of blessing. None is devoid of light to shine into the world. None is devoid of your love. Each rock and tree and cloud and creature, everything in this your good earth, O God, everything cries out in thanksgiving from the very fact and root of our being. Thank you. Oh God, we are particularly and especially and tenderly caring and praying for these members of our community known to us. Maddie, Pauline, Arlen, Victor, Marianne. And we pray alongside she who now dwells with you in glory, Adeline. Oh God, there are prayers that we would say aloud, prayers we would share if there were but words deep enough to capture them. So listen now, O God, to these, your prayers of your people, offered before you alone. And, O God, when we do not know how else to pray, we are grateful that we may always pray and pray rightly in your sight, that prayer which your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. you could see what I see, it would warm your heart. If you could see what I see, it might even make you believe in God. If you could see what I see, that is, if you could see you. An old church acting like a young church, a sanctuary chock full of the most interesting people on earth. If you could see what I see, you'd be smiling now. You'd be happy now. It's a beautiful sight from here. If you are new here and just passing through, you should know this. In a few minutes, we will do something together, something big and bold, something important and full of sacrifice, something full of joy and deep with meaning. You see, this is a church that has democratized generosity, a church whose ministries are fueled and powered by its members and friends, both near and far, and some worshiping with us by live stream. Hi, Nance. Hi, Megan. We practice radical generosity because we can do more together than any of us could ever do on our own, because it is in giving that we ourselves receive, because the world out there needs more kindness, more truth, more peace, more mercy, more love for the stranger and help for the alien. Your financial gifts ensure that our doors are wide open every day, that our children are nurtured in a strong and supple faith, that we stand alongside the poor and oppressed, that we work for God's justice and wage Christ's peace, that we make music and worship and praise the living God. So what's going to happen next is what one of the things we do best, music. All good gifts from Godspell, a song about unbridled thanksgiving. And during that time, you are invited to have a little chat with God. And you're invited to take a look at the insert, the commitment card and envelope in your bulletin, and write something there. If you're a visitor, we welcome your pledge to Old South Church, but if you don't want to do that, write something on the back, your something after your chat with God about your generosity. My friends, it is time to pray, time to chat with God. Stay where you are. After all good gifts, I'll be back with instructions.
And scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, and soft, refreshing rain.
So be devoted to one another and rejoice in hope. Give with simplicity. Show mercy with cheerfulness. And do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with love.
All things bright and good.
I really want to thank you, Lord.
It's time now, high time, God's time. As Mitchell takes up Mrs. Jarvis's reel, we'll all be invited to come forward at the direction of the ushers. The stewardship people should be down here about now with your baskets. You'll be invited to place your pledge, whether it's your weekly offering or your annual pledge, into the basket. And Mitchell is going to get us in the mood, get us moving, the morning's offering will be given and received.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Bless these gifts, O God. Bless and supercharge them. Turn dollar bills into food, checks into shelter, coins into clothing. Turn loneliness into companionship, pride into humility, privilege into generosity, and fear into understanding. Supercharge these, our gifts. Turn our giving cards into a new heaven and a new earth. And supercharge us, that we may be blessed and a blessing, that we may be heralds and stewards of your beloved community. In Jesus' name, and let the whole church say, Amen.
Thank you.
Church, go from this place loving God so much that you love nothing else too much, and fearing God just enough that you need fear nothing else at all. And may the blessing of Almighty God, our Creator, Christ, our brother and Savior, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and every day. And let the whole church say, amen.